Mustafa, hello, how are you?
Alhamdulillah.
First of all, what about your headache?
still there.
Still there?
Yes.
All the time?
All the time.
God save you. Now, tell me about the second part of your name. Is it Alu or something else?
So it's Ano.
Ano, yeah, that's right. Mustafa Ano.
It's fine.
Wa-alaikum salam.
So, we've seen that the European nations are coming together, forming something as EEC. I want to know the advantage and the disadvantages to the European nation and the whole world at large.
First of all, the advantages, the good news. The fact is that behind the working of the mind which conceived of this plan, or the minds which conceived of this plan, were hanging the swords of two world wars. Europe, in the state of different, as a continent, having so many different states with independent authorities, despite all their best efforts, got split again and again on the issues which in fact were economic issues, but the interests of various states were at loggerhead with each other concerning certain economic issues. This has always happened, and these things, when they grow further, they always, if not always, most often, produce wars. So, having read the whole, of course, they must have gone into the entire history and the background, reasons why these wars took place, they must have inferred that Germany seems to be the center to the whole issue. And as long as Germany has that capability of building itself a very powerful economic machinery and posing threat to the economic interests of other countries, and also gaining so much strength that it should go into their head, they must emerge supreme now and take the revenge of what rest of the Europe has been doing to them in the past history. They must have thought that this is a logical, inevitable conclusion, which would work exactly the same way as it worked previously. So, the first answer to this question was presented by Churchill, which is mentioned in his memoirs of the World War II. He suggested to President Roosevelt and also to Stalin that as long as Germany remains united, it will always pose threat to peace. So let us divide it into two parts. He willingly gave half of it to Russia. All right, take it and do whatever you like with it. And we have control over the other part, and we will befriend it, and a polarization will begin. He didn't say it in so many words, but this is exactly what he said very clearly, that to save peace in Europe, it is a must that this country must be divided into two. And a polarization must result from that. So German pitched against German. That would give peace to the rest of Europe, or guarantee some manner of peace for them. But the times changed. This division no longer suited the political requirements of the entire world, America included. So as the Berlin Wall fell, we can see that up to that time, already Europe must have realized that it was a folly to divide Germany. It became absolutely clear during the fall or collapse of the German Wall. But it was not a news to Europe only at that time. They must have calculated long before that these people, if kept divided and one half of it handed over to USSR, would create havoc with the peace of the whole world, because they are very special people, very industrious, and very disciplined. They will play a vital role in favor of USSR in the next world war whenever it takes place, because they were idealized. So as such, they already had second thoughts on this issue. So these factors must have given birth to, politically, the concept of one united Europe, in which Germany should be absorbed as a single, as one entity, not independent, but as a part of one united Europe. The second were the economic compulsions, which were related to the outside world more than the internal requirements. Germany could compete economically with the rest of the Europe, but the problem was not just that. The problem was that with America on the one end and China and Far East on the other, individually European countries could not have built their economy so powerfully as to compete with America on the one hand and the Far Eastern countries on the other, by themselves independently as small countries. So to work a plan of economy whereby the united might of European economy could stand on its own and compete fairly with advantage with other big countries of the world in the world markets. This must have been also a very powerful idea which drove them to forge some sort of unity. And other small factors of convenience, for instance, travel to European countries, doing away with passports and visas and all this nonsense, behave like more civilized people and let us enjoy jointly all that we have, all that possess, and share the possession of others as ours. This psychological factor must also have worked in the making of this idea. These are the good points, right? And the bad points are that this scheme has already created those very jealousies which they wanted to avoid. First of all, this did not bring into the focus of their attention, perhaps, obviously I feel, the factor that the national loyalties in Europe have sunk so deep and are rooted so deeply in their history and thinking that you simply cannot sever the ties of their national growth from their roots and plant them elsewhere as a garden with new roots to it. This new identification with Europe is a very serious problem, more so for the British, because they have a very glorious past of independence, of diplomacy which not only matched but more than matched any other diplomacy of any other people in the world. Politically conscious people of the world know that and would agree to this claim, that the British political awareness and diplomacy is rooted deep into the history of their colonization, and no other nation shares it equally with them. That is why America, despite being a very great country, has always been dependent on British advice on such matters, until Mrs. Thatcher came. Then a new era began of British giving in, handing in their own right of superiority in diplomacy and world politics to their elder brother America, which was resented, of course, by many other politicians, and they are trying to return back to their own independent entity, identity. So But yet, despite the fact of this overmuch leaning towards England, America, causing such bickerings in many parts of the British society, one thing they know, and that is certain, that history has put them in the bracket of Americas more than in the bracket of Europeans. Americas originally belong more to the British than to any other nation. By Americas, I mean Northern America, including Canada. And they have a natural, you know, affinity towards each other, a sense of deep association. So it is very difficult for Britain to ignore those historic ties and accept a new identity for themselves, which is limited to European confines. And when they accept it, then also they have to give in voluntarily the rights of an independent nation, because the majority of European countries would always tend to gang against Britain, because deep inside they have some disturbing experience of historical superiority of the British in politics and having its own way, having their own way. So these thoughts are not brought to the focus of intention clearly as I am defining them, but they go into the human psyche. They work without people taking notice of them so clearly. So something disturbing is happening to the British. Shall we be completely resigning ourselves that historic authority which we gained with so much labor in the past? With their majority, then they will be lobbying, naturally, which has already started. French lobby, German lobby, that lobby and that lobby. What is Britain in that lobbying when the continent as a whole considers itself to be the main representative of European land? Britain, of course, is an island, accepted as European, but still a step-European, like stepchild. So these factors are going to play a role in future. It's impossible to avoid them, to bypass them. The second bad point is that a pole would be created in Europe, ultimately against America. With the passage of time, American authority would be weakened, and as they gain more strength in their own economy, they are going to reject American, I don't want to say bullyism, but the American authority overmuch exercised on the European will. Then the race for the markets, if not an internal race between one country of Europe and another, it would be a race between America and Europe as such. And then on the other hand, America would bypass Europe and bring Japan closer to itself, and Korea, and some other Far Eastern countries, to offset the loss of its authority upon Europe. So there are very grave efforts to be witnessed in the near future, whereby the economic solution which they have found is going to turn into an economic problem for the entire world. Then Russia is next door to us. Russia cannot be absorbed into Europe as a single European entity, completely losing its identity. It's not possible. Russia's history has always been independent. When there was British Empire, there was also Tsarist Russian Empire. And they always go along with the other smaller states around them, comparatively small states, but very powerful states economically. And they cannot survive economically without interdependence on each other. Their industry throughout the communist period has been so well planned and designed, or badly planned and designed, that one part of USSR is the productive part and the other part is the industrial part. So they cannot survive independently of each other. Raw material comes from mostly from Muslim states, and the food also comes mostly from Muslim states, Kazakhstan, etc. And they are manufactured and processed industrially in Russia, not in USSR as a whole. Of course there is industry everywhere, but I'm talking of the highest concentration of industry to be in what we know as Russia, and in a state within USSR. So they are going to come into their own after a while, after surviving the shock of the change in their economy. They will ultimately settle down. And other nucleus would be created next door to Europe with a very strong economic machinery, so powerful that they can't realize at this moment actually how powerful that machinery is if put into operation. Because the economic machinery of USSR is highly technical. Technicality, if you speak of technicality and scientific education, Europe cannot compete with USSR in the area of fundamental industry. They can compete, of course, with USSR in the sophisticated items of daily use, in the production of such sophisticated items as excellent clothes, most beautiful cars, comfortable this and that. Russia can't beat with them. But per capita, Russia has far more industrious economists, scientists, as well as technologists in Russia, in USSR, than any country of Europe, or even if you put their might together, still USSR has an edge over this. So once their economy falls into steps, then they are going to turn into a very powerful economic machinery. Previously, it failed to produce impact because most of the production of the industry was directed at war machinery. If there is no threat of war anymore, as it will dissipate naturally within the next few years to begin with, then it will come back later. But this initial removal of immediate threat of war will give Russia ultimate advantage to divert its industry to other common day-to-day usages of the Russians themselves. They have been deprived of this. This is why there is so much suffering. But no more so. Already the shift is taking place. So these and so many other factors speak of a gloomy future in relation to the immediate advantages which we can see and which some of which I have counted. Right?
Thank you very much.
But why should you be interested in this question of Europe, while you should have paid more attention to the unification of African states, which are fighting with each other without drawing any cue from their history, without drawing any lesson from their history. They're fighting each other inside and outside. Gosh, what's happening there? Right?
Next time, maybe I'll come to Africa.
By the time you come to Africa, I hope Africa will be left. The way they are destroying each other, unbelievable. How the Sierra Leoneans are cutting the throats of Sierra Leoneans. How the Nigerian society is divided into warring factions on religious plane, on political plane, on economic plane. You know, things are happening in Liberia, have happened in Liberia and other parts of the state. What is happening in Zaire? These are very serious problems which are very close to the edge of the precipice. Then the moral states, the moral destruction of the society as a whole. Truth is fast disappearing. Integrity or honesty or trust are evaporating very fast from African soil. And again, unfortunately, AIDS is spreading like wildfire in many African countries. So all these are factors which should, you know, which should create a sort of panic among the Africans living outside in apparent isolated peace of Europe. It's a very serious question I have raised. I want to draw the attention of all Africans living in Europe or America or other Western countries to forget their own personal advantages and return to their country deprived of all resources, even the human resources. The best they produce of scientists seeks employment elsewhere in the advanced countries. So it is Africa far more to be worried about than anything that may happen to Europe. Right?
Thank you very much.